Ji, assalamu alaikum everyone. I hope you can hear me. Can anyone just signal if
they... Yes, sir.
Okay, all right, okay. So thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum everyone. Today is going to be our fourth lecture. And in this lecture, we'll talk about... We are gradually progressing from the simplest definition of symmetry in two-dimensional planes to more and more sophisticated descriptions of symmetry. So I would just like to start today's lecture by inviting someone to give a brief recap of what we've learned so far and the kind of operations, elements, and ideas that we've covered in the first three lectures. So could anyone become a volunteer here and describe to all of us what have been up to? Ji, Ali, aap kuch batayenge?
Sir, I think in the first lecture we talked about we first defined what a lattice is as a sort of skeleton on which we and then we defined the notion of convolution, how you build crystals using bases or I don't know. Okay, and then we defined the symmetry group of rotations C1, C2, to C3, C4, and C6. And then we, on top of it, we define symmetries due to mirror reflections. And then from then, we coupled it with inversion operations about a point. It would build the improper rotations, and then in the second lecture we mainly defined the 32 point groups in three dimensions, and in the last lecture I don't recall. I mean I haven't looked into it deeply enough.
All right, so very good. I think that's a fair enough description. So if I were to do a recap and I were to do it on paper here, we've talked about symmetry elements. And together with symmetry elements, there's the concept of symmetry operations. As Ali mentioned, we've highlighted a distinction between a lattice and a crystal structure. So one is the skeleton and the one is the skeleton with the flesh on top of it. The flesh in our case are atoms, electron densities, G.
We can't see your screen.
All right. I'm sorry. Thanks for reminding me. I'm sorry about this. All right. So we've talked about lattices and structures, and we've developed a concept of crystal structures gradually. So we started off with the simple idea of point rotations, and we figure out that in three dimensions, all structures, external morphologies, and lattices belong to one of the 32 point groups. Okay. So these point groups deal with rotational elements and roto inversion elements. So rotations followed by or preceded by inversion operations. All right. And we also figured out that there are 10 kinds of point operations. And then when we lump together these point operations, there are 32 point groups that can be formed, neither less nor more. So all the crystals, if you look at their external morphologies, can be described exclusively by one of those 32 point groups. Now, having these point groups puts extra constraints on the shape of the unit cell. And the shape of the unit cell, let me draw some unit cell here, which is the self-repeating unit inside a lattice. The shape of the unit cell is defined by three lattice vectors, A, B, C. Each one of them has a length, and there are three interaxial angles, alpha, beta, and gamma. So the point group operations put constraints on the shape of the unit cell, leading to what we call seven crystal systems. Of course, it's easier to remember the crystal seven crystal systems rather than the 32 point groups. But nevertheless, the point groups lead to the seven crystal systems. And then you can forget about the point groups. That's what most people do. Most physicists forget about the point groups and just look at the crystal systems. Now, when we have these seven crystal systems, so how do we go from point groups to crystal systems? The point groups put constraints on the shape of the unit cell. Then you look at your crystal system and then attempt to center it in different ways. And there are different kinds of centering. You could have face centering, C centering, body centering, and you could also have particular planes being centered. For example, in monoclinic, you have the B plane centered, etc. There's another kind of centering, rhombohedral as well, but that's a bit of a technical detail. I will not discuss it in the class. But once we attempt to center our seven crystal systems, we get 14 kinds of lattices, which are called Bravais lattices. And these 14 kinds are the only ones that can be made. If we attempt to center these crystal systems in any other way, either you pop out of the crystal system and go into a new crystal system, or the definition of the lattice just withers away. So there are only 14 types of Bravais lattices. So I have cubic, tetragonal, orthogonal, monoclinic, hexagonal, rhombohedral, and triclinic. So these are the seven crystal systems. And the cubic system admits primitive. It admits a body-centered and a face-centered. The tetragonal admits a primitive and a base-centered lattice. Orthogonal has a largest variety. It admits P, I, F, and C. The monoclinic has P and B. Some authors would like to center A face instead of B. The hexagonal is primitive, rhombohedral is primitive, and the triclinic is primitive. So these are the 14 Bravais lattices. And I hope you've started looking at the homework too. The homework invites you to jump out of these 14 Bravais lattices, but you'll find out that it's not possible to do that. So any questions up till this point? And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to devote 1 hour a week to tutorials. Or office hours. I'll just be available outside the class time, and I'm going to announce these hours when you are able to come to me in person. Of course, you could come to my office as well if you're around in Lahore, but I'll be available on Zoom. You can just pop by and we can discuss any outstanding matters regarding the course and the content of the course. So any questions up to this point?
Sir, I don't understand the motivation behind centering. Okay, matlab centering, hamare paas crystal systems the, humne centering apply ki, hua kya? What was the motivation behind it?
Okay, so if you allow me to go through today's class, I think you'll find answers to this question.
Okay.
So the short answer to your question is that centering gives you distinct symmetry operations, and it leads to distinct space groups, as we'll explain today. Okay. All right. So just ask yourself the question, if you were to center body-centered a primitive cubic cell to make a body-centered cubic unit cell, are any new symmetry elements popping up? The answer is a resounding yes. So if there are more symmetry elements, there are multiple ways opening up of putting atoms inside your crystal. All right. So new kind of crystal structure emerges. And this is what I'm trying to bring home the idea today. All right, so now, so far, we've been talking mostly about lattices. Lattices, as I've described, they are placeholders. And you put a motif or a basis on a particular lattice point. On each lattice point, there is a point group operation that is active. So you take a particular lattice point and all the symmetry elements will fall into one of the 32 point groups. Okay. And remember that in a lattice, so if I were to draw a cubic lattice, I draw cubic lattices quite frequently because they're the easiest to draw, even though they have the most number of symmetry elements. So if I were to draw this lattice and I put lattice points, which are just placeholders, these are not atoms, these are just placeholders, then all of these lattice points are equivalent. And I can make unit translations to the left, to the right, up, down. So I can make translations such as UA plus VB plus WC and end up at lattice points, at another lattice point. So these are translations by unit vectors, by unit cell vectors, all right? So every crystal structure will obey this periodicity in space, okay? But what we're concerned here at the moment is what is happening inside a unit cell, because the unit cell is a self-repeating unit. All right, so let's start our discussion of what we call space groups. Now, let me state at the upfront that there are 232 space groups in crystals. Neither more nor less. Just as there are 32 point groups or crystal classes and 7 crystal systems and 14 different kinds of lattices, there can only be 232 space groups. Nothing else works. And why am I spending so much time on these topics, even though you won't find them in Simon's book, and I've already shared another excellent primer on the subject with you titled Patterns in Crystals? Because crystallography is a dying art. Crystallography, not many physicists and material scientists know the nitty-gritty of crystallography. But I think, first of all, it's quite unfortunate to be missing out on these topics. A new generation is being born which doesn't know about crystallography. It has aesthetic pleasure, it gives fascination, and it also helps us look at the structural properties of materials and look at the structure of materials and solids and condensed matter from a perspective which goes totally unnoticed. So if you would like to design a new drug to treat corona, or you would like to design a new vaccine, you need to know molecular structure. Any new compound that is formed, which interacts inside the human body, it's imperative to know the molecular structure. Proteins, which are vital for life, they have a structure. Proteins also crystallize. So it's really important to be able to understand the hermetics or the nomenclature of crystallography. And that's what we're trying to do. And we're trying to do in a stepwise fashion. We started off with symmetry elements, talked about point groups, then invoked the concept of crystal systems, and now we are heading on to the most complicated step in this process, in this ladder, which are called space groups. All right, so now let's talk about space groups. Okay, and how do I motivate all of this? Now let's consider a point group. Okay, a point group. M2. All right. Now, does anyone recall what kind of crystal system does this point group belong to? So I can look up my tables here. So can I find MM2? Yes, here is MM2. Here it is, MM2. So MM2, the international notation of this point group is MM2. It's C2V. It has an identity operation, a cyclic operation C2, and two mirror planes, which are vertical. Okay, so I give you this information and you can always draw the stereogram for this. So let's draw the stereogram for this point group. And the name tells it all. M, there's a mirror plane, and a two-fold rotation axis. And this belongs to the orthorhombic crystal system. So let's first of all draw the stereogram. So in the stereogram, I always start off with a circle. For my convenience, I break the circle into four quadrants. I take an arbitrary point here. Now I need two vertical mirror planes. So here is one of them, and here is the other. So these are the two mirror planes. And I also need a two-fold rotation axis, which is perpendicular to the mirror planes. Okay, so these are my symmetry elements. So let's see what these symmetry elements do to this arbitrary object that we've placed. It's above the plane of the paper. This mirror plane creates a mirror image. This mirror plane creates another mirror image. And this mirror plane creates another mirror image. And all four of these points are above the plane of the paper, and they also conform to the two-fold rotation axis. Got it? Now this point group can belong to a lattice, and it can belong to a basis as well. So any collection of atoms, and what are atoms really? When we talk about condensed matter systems, we're mostly concerned with electron densities. So we can have a group of electron densities or a group of atoms or molecules or a basis placed at each point on a crystal lattice. And there are 14 types of crystal lattices. So let's take a primitive lattice belonging to the orthorhombic type. Okay, so now we have defined a basis. This is our basis. The basis has a point group MM2. Now we take an orthorhombic primitive lattice. And this is what it looks like. All three sides could be unequal. Orthorhombic means A need not be equal to B, need not be equal to C, but all three angles need be equal to 90 degrees. This is what orthorhombic means. And primitive means that there is a lattice point at each vertex. And this is how we generally define the x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. Okay. Now, if we were to place this basis on each lattice point, we can generate a crystal structure. Okay, that's what generation of a crystal structure means. You convolve the basis with the lattice, which means you place the basis at each lattice point. Okay, now interestingly, the crystal type is orthorhombic and the point group of the motif is also orthorhombic. So we're keeping things simple. We are putting an orthorhombic point group, one of the, I think, the five orthorhombic point groups onto the one of, onto an orthorhombic lattice so that everything remains simple. Okay, so this is a slightly technical point. But nevertheless, now we have an orthorhombic lattice and we're putting our basis on top of this orthorhombic lattice. And let's observe a projection from the top. So we look down onto this new crystal structure that is emerging, by the way, now, because we have a lattice and a basis, a crystal structure is emerging. So let's look at it from the top. So let's draw a projection of the XY axis. Oh, sorry, on the XY plane. So if I were to do that, so this is my x-axis, this is my y-axis, and this length here, which I do not want to clutter my image too much, this is A, and this length here from here to here is B. And A need not be the same as B. They can accidentally be equal, but in generality, they're not the same. Okay. Now, in all the description that I've done in these lectures, I'm conforming to standard notation. The crystallographer's notation, which has been standardized by the International Union of Crystallography. And they have come up with a series of tables and a table for each space group. And there are 230 leaflets in this table. So I'm going to conform to this, to the standard notation. And by the end of this course, you'll be able to understand what these tables look like. So now what I'm trying to do, I'm going to take this basis and put it on each lattice point. So I picked up the cluster, the conglomerate of atoms, and put them on one lattice point. And it's primitive. So that's all I need to know, really. But for the sake of discussion, let's put all of these collections of atoms on all the four lattice points that are observable in this projection. Sorry. All right, so you got it. So this point here, this lattice point is totally equivalent to this lattice point. So a basis exists here, and the same motif is repeated on all the lattice points, and just the vertices, okay? Just the corners, nowhere else because it's primitive. All right, so now placing this collection of atoms on a primitive orthorhombic lattice creates new possibilities. It has created new symmetry elements, by the way. So look at this, now look at this unit cell from a panoramic perspective. Look at all of the unit cell, not just the basis. When we were talking about the point group, at a point, we were only concerned with the motif. Now we have juxtaposed or placed these motifs on all the four corners of the projection. Got it? Now look at the unit cell as a whole. Take a deep breath. Look at the unit cell as a whole. Have new symmetry operations emerged? Just, I give you 1 second to 1 minute to think of it while I get a glass of water for myself. Just look at it. And my question is, Now look at the unit cell as a whole. Don't focus on just one basis. Are there new symmetry elements that have been created in the act of creating this crystal structure? And what are those symmetry elements? Feel free to discuss in between, but I'll be back. All right, so any answers to this question that I posed? Anyone would like to take a leap of faith? Come on, guys.
So didn't we say adding motifs cannot increase the symmetry of a lattice? मतलब जितनी lattice की symmetry रहती है motif add करने से वो बढ़ेगी नहीं. I'm going to say कि कोई extra elements नहीं है.
नहीं अब ये देखना है कि extra elements basis के अंदर तो नहीं आएंगे और अब हमने पहले तो हमने lattice की symmetry की बात ही नहीं की है. अब हम crystal structure की symmetry की बात करें. अब क्रिस्टल स्ट्रक्चर में कौन से सिमेट्री एलिमेंट्स हैं? अगर हम ये ऑर्थोरॉम्बिक बेसिस की बजाय कोई और मोनोक्लिनिक बेसिस डाल देते तब सिमेट्री रिड्यूस हो जाती क्रिस्टल स्ट्रक्चर की. लेकिन हमने जानबूझ के लैटिस की सिमेट्री और बेसिस की सिमेट्री ऑर्थोरॉम्बिक ही रखी है ताकि हम इस तरह की बहस में पड़े ही ना. अब मेरा सिर्फ माई ओनली क्वेश्चन इज what are the symmetry elements that are operative in this crystal structure? Because now we're talking about atoms as well. So I can draw a mirror plane exact in the exact middle. Right. So, is this a mirror plane? Yes, it is, because this object here is reflected here. This object here is reflected here. This object here is reflected here. So, there is a mirror plane that bisects this projection. Vertical mirror plane. Another mirror plane is created like this.
But sir, this was there before adding the bases, right? These two mirror planes.
Right. But if I were to add a different kind of basis here, these mirror planes wouldn't exist. So now what we're doing is we're trying to look at the crystal structure as a whole, which is this particular combination of atoms being placed on this orthorhombic primitive cell. What are the symmetry elements in this crystal structure? Got it? So if I were to put a different kind of basis here, these mirror planes may not exist. So we're looking at all possible combinations of atoms that could be placed on a crystal lattice and qualify for being a crystal, for becoming a crystal. Okay, so there are these two mirror planes that exist. Of course, all the edges or the faces are also mirror planes, but we need not consider all of them because they are equivalent. And the other thing is, are there any twofold axes of rotations that are created?
Yes, sir, there is.
Which one? Can you give an example, please?
So the kind that we have in MM2, the one passing through the middle intersection point of the two planes.
So here is one. Okay. In fact, here is another one.
Sir, wouldn't there be one along the diagonals as well?
Let's see. Let's see just a minute. So here's another one here. Here's another one here. Another one here and another one here. So these are twofold axes of rotation. And these are the symmetry elements located inside the unit cell of this, what we have now generated is a space group. And the symbol for this space group is PMM2. So now this is standard notation. P stands for primitive. And by looking at these symbols, you can tell that this is orthorhombic. So I'll explain that in a minute. And I'll come to Mariam's question as well. But what we've done, we've taken a crystal type, one of the 14 crystal types. And as a result, we've also chosen a particular basis with a particular point group. And we have put that basis on all the lattice points available inside that crystal lattice type. And what this does, it creates a unit cell and a certain arrangement of atoms inside the unit cell. Now, there are certain symmetry elements and symmetry operations that this collection of atoms, the geometrical arrangement of atoms, satisfies. And this leads to a group of symmetry elements which are mutually compatible. And the group of elements here that we're talking about is a mirror plane, a vertical mirror plane, which I've drawn with an arrow, and another vertical mirror plane, which I've drawn with two arrows, and two-fold rotation axes. One of them is at the edge. One of them is here, this one here. One of them is at the exact center. And then we have two-fold rotation axes at the center of the edges. Here is one, here is one. And so this point here is exactly equivalent to this point. So I'm not mentioning it here again. And this point here is exactly equivalent to this point. So I'm not mentioning this point again. So this group of symmetry operations in three dimensions, which arises because of the proper placement of atoms inside a lattice, is a crystalline space group. And there are 230 kinds of space groups of this kind. Now the question is, Mariam asked this question, can I put a diagonal mirror plane here? The answer is no, because this point here, inside this mirror plane, this should be reflected on the other side, but it should not be the enantiomer of the other. So if we were to make a mirror plane, if I had a comma here, this point here should be without a comma, but that's not the case. Therefore, the diagonal mirror plane does not exist. Okay. Did I answer your question, William?
Yes, sir. I was just confused that how do the two-fold rotation axes on the center of the edges work?
This one? This one?
Yes.
All right. So what a two-fold rotation does, what this is going to do Okay, so let's consider this particular two-fold axis of rotation. And let's look at a point, at this point here. What the two-fold axis of rotation does, it will bring this point here. Okay, so if I were to make this a z-axis, two-fold axis of rotation, it will bring this point all the way to here. Okay, so
wouldn't it be working on all four of the points?
It will work. So it will bring this point here. In fact, this green point will be brought here. This purple point will be brought here. This orange point will be brought here, and so on. Okay, so this is the action of this two-fold axis of rotation here.
Okay, sir, thank you.
This central two-fold axis of rotation will bring this entire basis over here in the exact same fashion that the comma will remain a comma, the non-comma will remain a non-comma. So this point, for example, will be brought here under the action of this two-fold axis of rotation. Okay, so this is why all of these become two-fold axes of rotation. And right, you got it. So this axis of rotation here is also an intersection of mirror planes. So we get a two-fold axis of rotation at intersection of mirror planes. And this point group that has been generated is called PMM2. Any questions?
If I have an arbitrary lattice with certain symmetry elements associated with it, so is it possible that adding atoms on top of it generates more symmetry elements than there were already present?
Yes.
I mean, all of these symmetry elements in this case were already present in the orthorhombic crystal system, right?
Right, but additional. Okay, let me give you another example just to answer your question. Suppose I have a C-centered orthorhombic lattice. Okay, and I place the MM2 point group basis onto an orthorhombic lattice. Okay, and it's C-centered now. Now C-centered means that I have this orthorhombic unit cell. I have these lattice points here. In addition to these vertices, I have lattice points at the center of the base. Now I look down upon the XY projection. All right, now there's a lattice point here as well. So let's place our motif onto the lattice points. Now it's an MM2 point group placed on the lattice point. So just for convenience, I'm drawing these lines. Okay, and each one of them is positive above the plane of the paper. And there is a comma let me see. Okay, I'm putting a comma here. Here, 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 comma here and a comma here. All right. Now what we have in this particular case is an C-centered Bravais lattice, an orthorhombic Bravais lattice, and an MM2 point group placed. So let's look at the symmetry elements. Of course, we're going to have the mirror planes again. So we have a mirror plane. All right, so now let's see what kind of mirror planes do we have. Is the bisector a mirror plane now? So this line here, which I've drawn, this one, through the exact middle, parallel to the x-axis, is this a mirror plane for this particular crystal structure?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
No. Are you sure? Is this a mirror plane? All right. It's so not. This is a mirror plane. Got it? Is this a mirror plane?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is a mirror plane. Now, the question is this a two-fold axis of rotation?
Yes.
Yes.
It is. Is this a two-fold axis of rotation? Yes, it is, because this point here is brought here because of this two-fold axis of rotation and so on. So these points remain two-fold axes of rotation. Now the question is, are there any other two-fold axes of rotations that are created?
Sir, are the edges also mirror planes?
This one here, the faces. Yes, they are mirror planes. We don't want to write them over and over again because it's understood that these will be mirror planes, because this object here is reflected here by the action of this mirror plane. But I didn't draw this mirror plane because I've already drawn the one in the middle. So are there any other two-fold axes of rotations that are created, which were not present in the PMM2 group?
Yes, just by centering.
But then can you identify another two-fold axis of rotation?
सर जो हमारी बेसिस है उसके सेंटर में
यहाँ पे इधर
सर आई कैन सी द पॉइंटर
इधर
जी
ये तो पहले भी था यहाँ पे भी है इधर है मैंने बनाए नहीं ये तो यहाँ मौजूद है पहले से ही दे आर ऑलरेडी देयर Any ones that are created which weren't present in the PMM2 space group?
Sir, ye jo humare rectangles ban rahe hain, chote red wale, inke middle mein.
Exactly. So, a two-fold axis of rotation is created here, and a two-fold axis of rotation is created here, and a two-fold axis of rotation is created here, a two-fold. So, putting an MM2 point group on a C-centered orthorhombic lattice has created new two-fold axis of rotation. Okay, so in the entire collection of atoms, and what lattice type are they being juxtaposed against, creates new groups, symmetry groups. Okay, so that's the key point. All right, now if at each basis point you were to add a basis with a lower symmetry than the MM2 basis, this symmetry elements will be reduced. So that's the key point. However, now having a different kind of lattice, which means a different kind of centering and the same basis, has created new symmetry elements. By the way, you will probably not know at this point that these operations also create glide planes. Here is one glide plane, here is another glide plane, here is one glide plane, here is another glide plane. But these are not necessary to describe the structure. They emerge automatically, and I haven't talked about glide planes as yet. So additional symmetry elements can be placed, and this collection of atoms, so which means that we choose a basis, a point group for the basis, and a crystal type, gives rise to a new space group. And that space group, this space group is called CMM2. C stands for the C-centered orthorhombic. So it's a C-centered orthorhombic space group. C represents it C-centered, and you can tell that it's orthorhombic because in orthorhombic, the X, Y, and C unit cells, they are distinct. So each axis is distinct from the rest because they have different lengths. So if you have three elements or three symbols written after P, I, or C, you can tell that it's orthorhombic, provided the certain other conditions are met, which means that the second element is not a three and so on. So it means that the x-axis has a mirror plane perpendicular to it, the y-axis has a mirror plane perpendicular to it, and the z-axis has a two-fold axis of rotation in this space group. And that's what you observe. If this is my x-axis, this is my y-axis, you observe that there is a mirror plane, choosing a color, a mirror plane perpendicular to the x-axis, this mirror plane here, which gives rise to this symbol M. Then you have perpendicular to the y-axis another mirror plane, this one, which gives rise to the second symbol. And then you have a two-fold axis of rotation here, this one, which gives rise to the third symbol. And this kind of symbolism represents its orthorhombic because you have to identify an x-axis, what happens across an x-axis, a y-axis, and a z-axis. Okay, so this is an orthorhombic space group, and there are 230 different kinds of space groups. So the easiest way of making space groups is take one of the 14 crystal types, take one of the 32 point groups, and put those point groups, elements or motifs satisfying those point groups on each of the lattice points of the 14 lattice types. So that's the simplest way of creating space groups. But in this process, only 73 of the 230 space groups can be created. And these are called symorphic space groups. And these space groups have the same elements as the point groups. They have 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 1 bar, 2 bar, 3 bar, 4 bar, and 6 bar. They have these 10 symmetry elements. But then there are other interesting symmetry elements that can be created, that can be present inside crystals. Okay, any questions up to this point?
Excuse me, sir.
Gigi.
Sir, हमने ये motifs add करके जो हमारी crystal lattice थी, उसकी symmetry को कम नहीं किया, हमने उसको restrict कर दिया, क्योंकि जो हमने अभी symmetry elements introduce किए हैं, glide planes और जो हमने नए two fold axis भी बताए हैं, तो अगर हम simple points को ही देखते, उस पे कोई हम basis वगैरह ना रखते, तो वो तो पहले भी exist करते ही थे।
लेकिन देखो ना, अब यहाँ पे इन सी सेंटर्ड ऑर्थोरॉम्बिक सेल CMM2 वर्सेस PMM2 प्लेसिंग द सेम बेसिस ऑन टू डिफरेंट लैटिसेस क्रिएट्स डिफरेंट सिमेट्री ऑपरेशंस
इनसाइड द यूनिट। सर सिमेट्री ऑपरेशन जो हैं, अगर हम यहाँ पे ये मोटिव ना रखते तब भी तो पॉइंट्स के दरमियान में वो सिमेट्री ऑपरेशन थे ही।
पॉइंट्स के दरमियान तो सिमेट्री ऑपरेशंस बिल्कुल थे, But now what we really need to get to the business of putting atoms inside the crystal lattice to make a crystal structure. Otherwise, all our discussion will be in empty air. If you don't consider atoms, if you don't, in real crystal structures, you have atoms, you have electron densities placed on side lattices. So we have to find out what kind of symmetry groups exist for such three-dimensional arrangements of atoms. You're right. If you don't put, if you keep the lattice bare, then all of these symmetry elements, the highest symmetry elements possible in that space group will be the symmetry of that particular lattice.
यानी कि एक तरह से हम फिर उसकी जो सिमेट्री है उसको रिस्ट्रिक्ट कर रहे हैं अगर हमारी बेसिस किसी इस तरह की होती कि इसमें हमारे पास अगर थ्री फोल्ड एक्सिस होता तो फिर उसमें हम कहते हैं कि उसमें कोई एडिशन हुई है आई गेस
हां बिल्कुल पुटिंग एटम्स गिव्स यू अ न्यू पर्सपेक्टिव ऑल टुगेदर ओके
ऑल राइट सर थैंक यू
नाउ वन कांसेप्ट दैट इज रियली इंपॉर्टेंट व्हेन यू लुक एट क्रिस्टलोग्राफी
सर
इज द फॉलोइंग If I draw my, so my PMM2 space group projection again, let me just draw the points, the objects for the PMM2 space group orthorhombic. All right, so there is the concept of equivalent positions. If you look at crystallography literature, there's a concept which you come across is of equivalent positions. And equivalent positions means that if I have an object placed at the location X, Y, Z, so this object here, this is X, this is my fractional coordinate y, and it could be at a height z. The elevation of this point could be z. Okay, above the xy plane, it could be z units above. Now, x, y, and z are fractional coordinates. They are written in terms of, so x is really the absolute position divided by a. Y is the absolute position divided by b. So they are relative to the size of the unit cell length. Okay, so corresponding to this x, y, z, all the symmetry operations that you've drawn, two-fold axes here, mirror planes all throughout. So there are four. So the symmetry operation that I've drawn can land x, y, z into four different kinds of positions. So this object here could end up here. Okay, so the coordinates of this point are x with a minus sign, which is generally represented as bar, x bar, y bar, and the same z. I could also generate a point here, which is x bar, y, z. I could also generate this point, which is x, y bar, z. So a bar on top of a fractional coordinate. So y bar really means minus y. So all the symmetry operations can yield acting on a general object. So the general object is probably this one here. It will generate these four objects at these locations, which I've written here. Okay, now I can specify, instead of specifying the one point is inside the unit cell and three points are in neighboring unit cells. Okay, so this point belongs to this unit cell here. This point belongs to another unit cell. This point here belongs to another unit cell. So I can specify all the points in one unit cell or in a unit cell and nearby points, in even though they are in adjacent unit cells. And that's what I've done over here. So all four of these locations, these positions are equivalent because they are related by the symmetry operations of the space group. So these are general equivalent positions corresponding to the space group. Got it? And on this space group, there are also special locations which are not, suppose I, for example, so if I, you look at my pointer here, I'm drawing in blue. If I look at a point on the z-axis and at the origin of this unit cell, will this point transform under any of the symmetry operations of this crystal structure? So if I had to take any point on the z-axis, will it transform? Will it change under any of the symmetry elements of the space group?
No, sir. Z hamara
wahi no, it's not. Because it's located on an axis of rotation. So there are special positions inside this space group. For example, 0, 0, z. X is 0, y is 0, and z could be anything. This, an atom placed on this location will remain invariant under all the operations of the space group. Likewise, an atom on this axis here, an atom on this axis here, an atom on this axis here will remain, all of them will remain invariant. I don't need to specify the atom here because it's this equivalent to this atom here. So I just need to specify the four atoms on the four axes which are on the left of this figure. So I can have special position 0, 1/2 z, 1/2 0 z, 1/2, 1/2 z. Any atom placed on these special positions that will remain invariant under the symmetry operations. Now this position is labeled, could be labeled 1a, this could be labeled 1b, 1c, 1d. Okay. So now, are you with me on this? So 1a exists here. This is 1b. So sorry, this is 1b, 1c, 1d. Okay, got it? So elements on these axes of rotation, they remain invariant under these rotations. Now this nomenclature is also quite unique to crystallography. The one represents multiplicity and A is called a Wyckoff symbol. Okay, multiplicity means there is, if I were to do a symmetry operation, the point, any atom at the location 1A will remain at 1A. It will not go anywhere else. So that's what the 1 means. And there are four kinds of operations of this kind, 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D. So B, C, D are arbitrary. They're called the Wyckoff symbols. But then if you consider a point if I were to consider a point here lying on this edge, consider a point lying on this edge at any value of x. So an arbitrary location is any x, y is 0 here, and any z. So will a point lying on the orange plane if I were to do a transformation, where would it go? If I were to choose any symmetry transformation belonging to this space group, where would it go? It would go to a corresponding point here, which I've drawn in purple. So the orange transforms to purple, and the purple transforms to orange. And corresponding to a point X, Y, Z, what I would get is a point at the same Z, still at Y equals 0, but now X will be 1 minus X. But then I could write this purple thing I could draw over here as well, because the two purples are totally equivalent. They are related by translation vectors. So I could write X bar Y Z. So a point X comma 0 comma Z is equivalent under all the symmetry operation of this group to a point X bar comma 0 comma Z. So this pair of special positions also exists. So I could have X 0 Z paired up with X bar 0 Z. And these two positions represent a special position of multiplicity 2, because there are two points, and I can put a symbol 2A. Sorry, I could put, since I've already consumed symbols up to D, I could put 2E. Then I can have 0YZ, 0Y bar Z. This is labeled 2F. The EFG are arbitrary, by the way, so don't worry about this too much. X half Z, X bar half Z. This is 2G, half YZ, half Y bar Z is 2H, and so on. Now, is this making a little bit of sense? I know it's slightly cumbersome, but is it at all making sense?
Yes, sir. Got the idea.
So if I were to draw, so let me draw a point. So a point on this pink region will be transformed to a point on this blue region, right? A point on the pink region has X arbitrary, Y is 1/2, and Z is arbitrary. So Y is 1/2, X arbitrary, and Z arbitrary. This point is transformed under all the symmetry operation of this group to the blue point, to the blue points. Now the blue points here, which I've drawn over here, they are the same as blue points over here in a neighboring unit cell, because they are related by a translation vector, in this case small a, which is the length along X. Therefore, the pink points are related to the blue, and the blue can be specified, the special positions can be specified by X bar, Y is still half, Z is arbitrary, and X is now the negative of the original. So a point here goes here. So this is X, this is X bar. Yes, Mariam.
Also, wouldn't we multiply the vector with a 2A? The resulting coordinate, sorry.
Can you please say it again?
So I'm asking, wouldn't we multiply the result after what we have gotten after the transformation with 2A?
2A is just a, what is 2A?
So A is the length, and 2 is like what we have considered. We've considered the line above and not the line which was below. So wouldn't we multiply it with the 2A as well?
No, you need not multiply it with the 2a. So a is just a is this length here. You're doing a translation. So the two light blue or cyan lines that I've drawn, they are equivalent. So if I have a point here, there's a corresponding point over here, and they are related by a unit translation, a units. That's what it means. There's no multiplication here. Okay, there's no multiplication here, Miriam.
Okay, sir.
So I'll be available in the office hours if you would like to talk a little bit more about this. So we can generate all the symorphic space groups by putting one of the 32 point groups on the 14 crystal lattice types and putting them in the proper unique distinct orientations as well. But there are other kinds of symmetry operations. And I would just like to point towards those symmetry operations. And these symmetry operations now involve translations. And here I'm talking about translations less than a unit cell dimension, smaller than A, smaller than B, smaller than C. Because the unit translations, they are always operative in any lattice whatsoever. So what does there are symmetry operations that involve translations smaller than the unit cell length translations. One of them is called a screw operation. In order to understand a screw operation, suppose I draw an axis and an object sticking out of the perpendicular to the axis. Now, if I were to do a 90 degrees rotation about this axis here, this is my axis. So suppose it's a four-fold axis of rotation. I would end up here, right? But then if I were to translate this object by a certain step size, suppose that step size I call A by 4. And this I would like to remove this thing here now. So I do a 90 degree rotation followed by, I do a C4 rotation or the 4 rotation followed by a translation. Then such an operation is called a screw operation. Okay. If I were to do another screw operation on this new object that I formed, I would end up here, but then I translate by unit A by 4, so I end up here. And then I repeat the process. So this length is A. After 4 steps of this roto-translation process, roto followed by translation, after 4 steps, I get back to the original. So this is an example of a screw axis. And the screw axis is denoted by, so you could have a screw axis is generally denoted by this symbol. This is a 4-1 operation. So I do a 90 degree rotation followed by a translation of A by 4. I could have a 4-2 screw operation, which looks like, which is given this symbol. I do a 180 degree rotation followed by a half unit cell translation. I could do a 4-3 rotation, 3-270 degrees rotation. Okay. And a 4-4 rotation is, of course, the identity operation. So these are called screw operations. And I could have screw operations about A, about B, about C. Generally, screw rotation axes are represented by half arrows. Okay, so when we involve screw operations into the symmetry operations, we can generate non-symmorphic space groups, and we can fill up all the 232 space groups as well, provided we consider glide operations as well. Now, glide operations are roto reflection operations. Now, let me give you a simple example of you must have seen rowers on a canoe. So if you look at rowers on a canoe, there's a person here with a canoe here, a person here with a canoe in this orientation. Okay. So what this is really is, there's a mirror plane here followed by a translation parallel to the mirror plane. Okay, so this is what is meant by a glide plane. If I were to draw this in terms of crystal structure, so let me draw a projection of a crystal structure. Suppose I have a point over here, plus. This is my X, this is my Y. If I had a glide plane, say, let me, here. Dashed lines generally represent glide planes. So what the glide plane does is, this is a vertical mirror plane. It reflects this point about the mirror plane. I end up here. And then I translate by A by 2. So I end up here. And I need a comma sign because I've involved a reflection. So this is A by 2. So a mirror reflection about CV followed by a translation of A by 2. This is a compact notation for such a glide plane. And since this glide plane is parallel to the x-axis, it's called an A plane or an A glide operation. Got it? I can also have a B plane. So a B plane means I take this unit cell and now I draw a glide plane which is parallel to the y-axis. This object, I take a reflection about this mirror plane and do a translation by B by 2 units. This is a B mirror operation, sigma V followed by B by 2. So this is an example of a B glide plane. Another kind of a B glide plane, by the way, could be if we were to do a mirror reflection about the XY axis. So an object here goes below because of this mirror plane that now lies in the plane of the screen, followed by a B by 2 rotation. So I end up here with a minus sign, of course, because now the mirror plane is in the plane of the screen. So this is also a B glide operation because I'm translating parallel to the Y axis. So I can have a B, A glide plane. I can have a C glide plane. I can also have an N glide plane, which involves a translation of A by 2 plus minus B by 2 or A by 2 plus minus C by 2. I could also have D glide planes, which are important in diamond, and diamond is the structure that we're going to look at in the next class. So D glide planes involve translations of this kind. So when we combine the 14 crystal types with all kinds of symmetry operations, which now involve translational symmetry operations, the glide planes, as well as the screw planes, we can generate all 32 space groups. All of them. And what I'm going to do in the next class, I'm going to look at 3 or 4 examples of archetypal crystal structures, diamond, zinc blend, sodium chloride, and describe them in the language of space groups. That's what I intend to do in the next class. And in the meantime, I would like you to do the homework as well. So please go through the primer that I've shared on Google Drive. It's an excellent textbook on this subject. It's out of print. Very few people know about it, but it's a trove of treasures. So any questions, my friends? The goal of these lectures is not to teach you everything about crystallography, but at least orient you and motivate to you that even though the notation, the diagrams, the symbolism look very archaic and mystical, still there is scientific meaning to all of this. And everything is making mathematical sense to the fullest degree.
Sir, we mentioned there are 32 point groups and now there are 230 space groups. These numbers, from the face value, these numbers seem arbitrary. I mean, why are there 32 point groups and this number of space groups?
So the order of a group is bounded. So you can have a certain number of elements in a particular kind of groups. One symmetry operation necessitates the other and it excludes the other. So you can prove this mathematically that only these 32 point groups and only the 230 space groups exist. It can all be proven mathematically. And this is the ambit of group theory. It's not arbitrary. All right, any more questions?
So do these rotor reflections, the glide plane operations, do they commute as well?
Rotor reflection, commute, what do you mean by commute? You could do the reflection before the rotation or the rotation before the reflection, it doesn't matter.
Okay.
All right, any more questions? Likewise, in the rotor translation, the screw operations, you could do the rotation or the translation. Either one of them could be precede the other. It doesn't matter. The two subsets of the rotor translation, the rotor inversion, and the rotor reflection, they commute, mutually commute with one another within the same set.
Okay.
Now, let me just finish off this lecture by drawing a graphical symbol of one of the space groups to see the beauty of this. I draw a projection for the space group P, 4, 3, 2, 1, 2. Now this is a space group and I immediately know it is orthorhombic. So it's primitive and this is the x-axis, the y-axis, the z-axis. There is a screw operation, 4 sub 3 screw operation about the x-axis, a 2-1 screw operation about the y-axis, and a 2-4 axis rotation about the z-axis. So if I were to draw the symbol of this, the graphical symmetry operations of this orthorhombic space group, these are the points that I have. I have so all of this becomes at one stage a work of art and a catalog that you need to consult to see what these space groups mean. But once you get the hang of the symbolism and the operations, everything is going to make sense. And then you can use a computer program to work out all the equivalent positions and the special positions, etc. All right, so this is my x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. So by the way, if there's a four in the symbols, after the type of the lattice, if it starts with a four, it means that this is a tetragonal space group. If there's a four, okay? So this is a key identifier for a tetragonal system. There's a four or a four sub one or a four sub three. So these sides are equal. So there are 4 by 3 axes. The screw operation, which is along X, is represented by these half arrows here, right? So let me first draw all of this and then I will explain. It's easier for me to do it that way. Of course, you don't need to remember this. No one remembers this, but at least we should be able to explain what's going on. Now see how complicated all of this can get. So this is a particular space group of the tetragonal kind. It has threefold axes of rotation, 4 by 3 screw planes parallel to X. So here they are, this one and this one. This one and this one. And 1 by 8 means that this screw axis is not in the basal plane. It's at an elevation of 1 by 8 units, fractional units. So 1 by 8 C, it's at a height of 1 by 8 C, and it's a screw axis. Likewise, this is a screw axis, which is parallel to the Y axis. And it's a two-fold screw axis. Here it goes. So you do a 180 degree rotation followed by translation by half of B units. And of course, there's a two-fold axis of rotation as well, parallel to the Z axis. So these small letters or symbols represent the elevations of these symmetry operations about the basal plane. So all the symmetry elements of this space group are represented compactly in the form of a chart on the international tables for crystallography leaflets. So I'll give you some more examples, and we'll go through those examples in the next lecture. Just want to finish off by saying that this is a beautiful subject. It's really important. It's really mind-boggling. And once you master the details and the hermetics of crystallography, you can get a deeper insight into looking inside the crystal structure and looking at materials and looking at how the atoms are arranged inside condensed matter systems. All right, so inshallah, we'll see each other on Thursday now with some real examples. All right, my friends, thank you very much. Thanks a lot for your time, and khuda hafiz.
Love you, sir.